he didn't want dinner. That was strange. Lazarus loves his food. And then he went to bed early, which really isn't like him. He's a night owl. Lazarus is the night owl. I knew something wasn't right.
I sat with him that night and the next, wiping his burning forehead with a damp cloth, holding his listless hand, trusting that Jesus would soon be there.
I had sent for him. He could help. He would fix this. He loved Lazarus. He loved us. Surely what he did for all those he didn't know, he would do for us. I promised Lazarus that Jesus would heal him. He just needed to hold on.
Do you know how you can see it sometimes? It's in a person's eyes, that look, that they're letting go of this world, just a little bit at a time.
Those 4 days might as well have been 4 lifetimes. Everything I thought I knew about Jesus fell apart. It's not that he wasn't the Messiah. It wasn't that. It was more personal. He loved us. I really thought he would be there for us. I trusted him.
My doubt crushed me. I sat in our house, and people came and people went. I didn't even know who was there. I would not wish what I went through upon anyone. My brother, our brother, was dead, sealed in a tomb. When Jesus called for me, I didn't want to go. I didn't know how I would face him. And when I did, I fell on my knees and I cried and I cried. If you had just been there, I said to him, then my brother wouldn't have died. And you know what he did? He knelt and he wept with me.
We took him to the tomb. When he asked for the stone to be rolled away, it broke me. And then he said, didn't I tell you that if you would just believe, you would see God's glory?
The realization dawned. He felt my pain, our pain. I didn't have to trust in my own outcome of him, my own thoughts of what he was.
I hated every one of those 4 days. I hated the way I felt. God didn't make any sense. It was as if he didn't even care. But I came to realize that without those 4 days, before, I believed in him. But afterwards, I believed him.
We didn't understand it then, but we do now. Jesus doesn't just give life.
He is life. He is the Christ. He is the Son of God who comes into this world, and whoever believes in him will live.
Welcome to our online service. Kicked off today with a dialogue as we turn our attention to Easter. And isn't it wonderful that we get a time in the year where we can put our attention onto all that Easter means to us as believers? Such an important time of year. Today is Palm Sunday, and on Friday we will have a Good Friday service available online, but also you can book an in-person gathering. You can come and be part of the service here on Good Friday. To go to our website, harvest.co.za, to book for that. And do book your Easter Sunday service too if you want to attend an in-person gathering We are running services at 9 a.m. on Sunday and 5:30 p.m. as we have been. And I say services because they all start at the same time, but multiple venues running with worship leaders and pastors for you to come and meet in person. All these Easter services also running online on YouTube. If you want to book a venue though, go to harvest.co.za. I want to remind you that on Easter Sunday, we will be doing baptisms at both the 9 a.m. and 5:30 p.m. services. Please go to the website or call in at reception to book for that so we can know who you are and we can prepare for that. We want to baptize people after a long wait. We really are looking forward to baptizing people. And for obvious reasons, I don't need to say this, this will be in person only. Please put your name down. And I encourage you to bring your friends and family to come and witness that if you're getting baptized. But do let us know if you're going to do that. And Father, we want to pray now for the rest of the service. We thank you, Lord, that we can put our attention on you as we move into Easter now. We can put our eyes on the cross, the glorious cross, all that went before it, all that happened through it, and all that we live in now as a result of that moment in history. I pray, God, as we worship you now, we would truly have our eyes on you and on the cross and on all that you did. And I thank you that you want to meet with us in a special way today. So we give this praise and worship to you now. In Jesus' name, amen.
Yeah. Death could not hold you, the veil tore before you. You silenced the boast of sin and grave. The heavens are roaring, the praise of you.
Father, we give all glory and honor and praise to you. I thank you that we've been able to offer our praise to you. We've been able to offer our worship to you. And we thank you, Lord, that you hear every word, every note, every song. And I know, God, that it reaches up to heaven and you hear it. And we pray that you would have been blessed by our praise and our worship to you. I thank you, Lord, that in your incredible love for us, even as we have given of ourselves in worship, Lord, you reached out and touched us, even though it was for you. It was all for you. You, in your love for us, have blessed us and touched us through this time of worship. We give you glory and honor, and we thank you for this in Jesus' name. Amen. This is a time where we now honor the Lord in a different way. We honor him with our finances and the first, the best of what he's given us as we return the tithes and offerings. We know that this is an important part of worship. It is an important part of acknowledging that God is first in our lives. He's the King. He's the Lord over every area of our lives, even over our wallets. So, Father, I thank you for the tithes and offerings that come in. I thank you, Lord, for the faithful givers. I pray your blessing and your multiplication upon that which is sown. God, I pray for your provision, that you would give more seed to the sowers. We thank you, Lord, that your kingdom is one of generosity. Your kingdom is one of a heart that is free of the love of money and a heart that releases finance into all your kingdom work. But from that place, we can live in in your provision, God, and all that you want to do in and through our finances. So your blessing upon it, the money that's come in, I pray, your blessing upon it, and your blessing upon those who give. We thank you, Lord Jesus, for all that you do. And at this time, we would pray, Lord, for those who are struggling, who've lost work through all that we've been going through. We pray for your blessing upon them and your provision of work and finance and income. We pray and ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Today's speaker is a spiritual father in my life and also happens to be my biological father. And I know him as Dad, you know him as John, Pastor John. The Bible tells us to give honor where honor is due. And before I hand over to him to share the word today, I want to take a moment to honor him in a very special year of his life. This year, he and my mom celebrate 25 years in full-time ministry, 18 years as a senior pastor of Harvest, and for the last 7 years, he's been leading the Harvest cluster. And my dad, or John, as you all know him, is the kind of person that doesn't expect any fanfare around him, so this is a surprise for him. And today, we want to acknowledge his role in this church as we celebrate 25 years of ministry. We want to acknowledge his role in this church, and I do this not because I'm his son, but as the third senior pastor of Harvest, I want to honor what he established over many years of faithfulness. In 1976, he graduated as a medical doctor, but from the early days, he always had a deep sense of a call of God to full-time ministry on his life, that one day this would happen. And in fact, he preached his first sermon at his local church the night before his final surgical exam. But he gave medicine his all, and by the early 1980s, he'd become the superintendent of a mission station hospital in KwaZulu-Natal. He put his medical training and his mission heart to use in a community that he served faithfully. In between being a doctor, he served in the local church too, even preaching from time to time. From there, the Lord led him and my mom to take our family to what was then called Port Elizabeth. And we joined Harvest about a year after it was established. And by 1986, he was one of the elders and remains one to this day. He served this church in those years part-time while building a medical practice in the city. I have many memories of him sharing how he was able to serve not only the physical needs of his patients, but their spiritual needs too, as God was preparing him. God had a plan, and in 1996, he took over from Pastor Ivan Foster, who we honor as the founding pastor. He took over from Ivan as the second senior pastor of Harvest, where he began this 25-year journey in full-time ministry. The Herald newspaper article at the time quoted him saying, I've always known in my heart I'd enter some form of ministry. It was just a matter of waiting and preparing for the right time. God's timing was perfect. Harvest grew exponentially in the years that followed, not just as a local gathering, but in its influence into the nations. His hunger for the presence of God saw many people come into life in the Spirit in a powerful way. He wanted us to become a presence of God church. And that's something we live in, and it's something that we fight for to this day. John's message and vision, which became known as giving the church back to the people, resulted in multiple ministries being birthed out of Harvest, which now have a global impact. His mission heart, which developed many years before, launched Harvest into reaching the nations. And at the turn of the century, about 20 years ago, he committed us as a church to reaching the unreached people groups of Kenya. And today we have local missionaries in many of their previously unreached tribes. Everything he does is motivated by a deep love for the people. And I've watched his life. It's never been about what will make him popular or what will benefit him personally, but what's best for those under his leadership. And we live in the many values he's imparted to us. One of our values, which we call team leadership, is something the Lord used him to weave into the very fabric of how we operate today. Humility and generosity are also foundations for ministry, which he built in us and into this family church. And we live in the blessing and the peace that those values bring. The decision to live in the Spirit and not fall back on human wisdom. That decision is a lifelong ministry decision that you, Harvest, are living in the benefit of today. And even if you're new and have never met him before, you're living in the benefit of this legacy. So would you join me as we thank the Lord and as we celebrate 25 years of Kingdom Impact, online and at all our in-person services. Would you please put your hands together for one of the founding fathers of this church, Pastor John Scholes.
Today is Palm Sunday, which always falls on the Sunday before Easter, and as you know, next Sunday is Easter, so of course today is Palm Sunday, and in many ways, Palm Sunday, as it came to be called, was the beginning of the end of Jesus' ministry here on earth. But it was the beginning of the end in some ways, but I've actually just been thinking about it and wondering if it wasn't just not the beginning of the end, but the end of the beginning of what is a glorious future that still lies before us all in Christ. So I grew up in denominational church, and I remember on Palm Sunday being given a crucifix, which was made of palm fronds when I was a young boy. And it was, I guess, meaningful at the time, although I really didn't have much of a clue what it was all about. And traditionally, the church has celebrated Palm Sunday as a very significant event. We, in the sort of charismatic type of churches, have tended to ignore the traditional or orthodox church calendar for some reason. And maybe it was a reaction or just the perception of a kind of dull religious behavior without life in the Spirit. But I have no doubt that the Holy Spirit has been very much part of all of the life-giving celebrations throughout history. And I really do believe that dates and times and seasons are important to the Lord. And one of the main reasons I've tended over the years to avoid focusing on the events around Easter is because I find in some way it's a little unbearable to have to walk through what Jesus endured for us just in my mind, let alone having to go through it. And emotionally, I've really battled to cope with the violence and the hatred against him. And in my mind, you know, imagining what actually happened is probably easier to avoid. So I kind of try to avoid it. But when I look back over what's now been 45 years or so since I preached my very first message when I was candidating as a lay preacher in the Methodist Church back in 1976, I don't think I've ever preached about Palm Sunday except maybe on one or two occasions. And the only reason I can do so today is because, I guess most importantly, I feel that's what the Holy Spirit has been pointing me towards. But also because almost 4 years ago now, I faced the possibility of death head on when, as some of you may remember, I had multiple pulmonary emboli as a complication of a biopsy, and then I was told I had prostate cancer, and I had to go through all of that, and I was facing either a quick death from the pulmonary emboli or a slow death from the cancer. And when you face things like that, you face head on into the reality of what's before us all. I'm truly grateful to the Lord that I'm free of it all now, but it was an incredible learning experience and I wouldn't have missed it for anything. And as a result, I've been now so focused on the victory that is ours in Christ in the life that is still to come, that I see Easter and therefore Palm Sunday in the light of the resurrection now. And that has changed everything. 1 Corinthians 2 verse 9 says, you know, that this is what the scriptures mean when they say, no eye has seen, no ear has heard, and no mind has imagined what God has prepared for those who love him. We have an incredible future in the resurrected realm of that which lies ahead. So let's read the account of Palm Sunday together and go back to that. So I'm going to read to you out of Matthew's Gospel and his account of it in Matthew 21, verse 1 to 10, headed the triumphal entry. Now, when they drew near to Jerusalem and came to Bethphage, to the Mount of Olives, then Jesus sent two disciples. And he said to them, go into the village in front of you, and immediately you will find a donkey tied and a colt with her. Untie them and bring them to me. If anyone says anything to you, you shall say, The Lord needs them, and he will send them at once. This took place to fulfill what was spoken by the prophet, saying, say to the daughter of Zion. Can I just break for a moment there and say this? This was prophesied some 500 years before it happened. I always am amazed when I think 500 years before it was written down by the prophet Zechariah that Jesus would ride into Jerusalem on the back of a donkey. Say to the daughter of Zion, Zechariah said, behold, your king is coming to you, humble and mounted on a donkey, on a colt, the foal of a beast of burden. And the disciples went and did as Jesus had directed them, and they brought the donkey and the colt and put on them their cloaks, and he sat on them. Most of the crowd spread their cloaks on the road, and others cut branches from the trees and spread them on the road. And the crowds that went before him and that followed him were shouting, Hosanna to the Son of David. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. And when he entered Jerusalem, the whole city was stirred up, saying, who is this? Who is this? And to understand Palm Sunday, we must in some ways understand the first century custom or the kind of situation that existed under the Roman Empire and in Roman rule. A king, if he was to be appointed a king within that empire, had to be ratified by the Emperor Caesar in order to be officially accepted as a king. And so in many ways, what's called Christ's triumphal entry into Jerusalem is actually his departure, his triumphal departure procession through the city. Departing in the context of that day to be crowned, in this case, as the King of the universe by God the Father himself. And then to return. And when he returns, he will return as the King. So this first Palm Sunday at the beginning of what's known now as Passion Week is really just the end of the beginning of what is yet to unfold when the King returns. And you have to appreciate the procession was on the back of a humble donkey. It was hugely understated. But the people came out in their droves, and I wonder if some of them were expecting him to overthrow the Romans, because he came so humbly in the end, and in many ways quietly. And I think people were disappointed, because a few days later the crowd were totally against him and shouting for Barabbas. It's important that we see what happens and how the Lord set this all up, because when he returns next time, things are going to be done very differently. He's coming back not on a donkey next time, but he will be coming back on a war horse. We read it out of Revelation 19, verse 11. And it says this, it says, then I saw heaven opened, and behold, a white horse. The one sitting on it is called Faithful and True. And in righteousness he judges and makes war. His eyes are like a flame of fire, on his head are many diadems, and he has a name written that no one knows but himself. He is clothed in a robe dipped in blood, and the name by which he is called is the Word of God. And the armies of heaven, arrayed in fine linen, white and pure, were following him on white horses. He will return with absolute power when he comes next as King of the universe and restores all things here on earth. And just an interesting aside, something that's worth noting on Palm Sunday, is that the next time palm branches are waved, it will be before the very throne of the King. In Revelation 7, verse 19, it says this, and behold, a great multitude that no one could number, from every nation, from all tribes and peoples and languages, standing before the throne and before the Lamb, clothed in white robes. And then this statement, with palm branches in their hands, and crying out with a loud voice, salvation belongs to our God who sits on the throne and to the Lamb. And that's what's still lying before us. These things are going to be completely different to that which happened on Palm Sunday when Jesus got humbly on the back of a donkey. That will not be what happens next time. And he who sits on the throne, you know, will shelter them with his presence. They'll hunger no more, neither will they thirst. The sun will not strike them, nor any scorching heat. For the Lamb in the midst of the throne will be their shepherd. And he will guide them to springs of living water, and God will wipe away every tear from their eyes. Until then, though, I guess we live in a broken world, and we are living in a very broken country. This last year has been very revealing. It's shown up the very worst of humanity. But we thank the Lord at times also, because at times we've seen the very best of humanity. The corruption has been on a scale that boggles the mind. You know, what's been exposed in the last while is unbelievable. Political infighting and failed leaderships everywhere. And greed and hatred and racism, they've all stuck their ugly heads out. And then the average person in the country has been faced with failure upon failure. You know, you hear constantly businesses that have gone down and people that are in financial difficulty and stuff that's happened. And some businesses are still going down, and there will be no doubt many others who go through very hard times. It's been tough. It's been very tough, and it's been very hard on the average person. And many are facing closure in their business world, not knowing how to be honorable in the process. It's tough. As a Christian, it's extremely tough to know what to do. People have been sick and many have died. All of us would probably know of someone who's died, and not just from COVID, but, you know, some certainly as a consequence of COVID, and some because COVID shut down things that should have been available to them. And yeah, somehow there's just this lingering sadness and a sense of loss in the country. And lies and fake news have, you know, they've disappointed all of us. There's a proverb that says that hope deferred, it's Proverbs 13:12, it says, hope deferred makes the heart sick. And many of us have had our hopes dashed to the ground over this time. Many of them by COVID, some not by COVID. And I was just as I was thinking, contemplating back over the years and thinking back to the 1970s and 1980s when we were in the height of the charismatic renewal. And as charismatics in those days, we had entered into a new level of faith, and the whole faith movement had taken off, and it was extremely exciting. I mean, they were incredibly exciting days. But then somehow we got into the extremes. You know, as the pendulum swings from just dead religion into this hyper-faith thing, we got into the situation where people would, you know, it was called the, you know, you could name it and then frame it and then claim it, because, you know, we are people of faith, and so you could have whatever you wanted. And I remember someone asking me at the time, you know, where's your faith? Because I had car insurance. And then, you know, it was frowned upon to put anything into pensions, because, you know, God will look after you. And we were being urged to live in a faith bubble of note. And then that bubble somehow was popped by the reality of everyday life in a broken world where the kingdom is already, but actually not yet. And that's been the challenge that I've had to face, but that has been answered for me in this, that it is a kingdom that is here, but not yet. And I remember someone preaching at Harvest soon after I took over as senior pastor here all those years ago now, saying that everyone who was sick had to be healed. There was no option. Healing was an absolute, because we follow in the steps of Jesus, and he never turned anyone down. He healed everyone, and we need to do the same. And as a senior pastor, it caused havoc for me, you know, and also with my medical background, because I've been through so much illness, and I want to say we're still living in Plan B. Plan A is coming, but we're living in Plan B. And sadly, the preacher who came and put us under all this pressure at that time, I heard some years later his wife died from cancer. And so his theology hadn't worked for him either. And we were put on a guilt trip because we did not have enough faith. And so we beat ourselves up on that. And I've only come to peace on this since accepting, as I've just said, that we are part of a kingdom that is here, but not yet fully manifest. And so there are these redemptive moments when the king steps into the here and now. And as Jesus said, when you see the demons flee, the kingdom of God's here. And when you see the sickness flee, the kingdom of God's here. But there is a mystery around the kingdom. And the reality is that we wait for the fullness of the kingdom to manifest so that all will be healed and all demons will flee. And the day is coming when he will dwell with us in the new heaven and the new earth, and he will be our God and we'll be his people. But until then, I have to reconcile my faith with the reality of what's going on around me. And what's going on around me at the moment is not nice, and I can't live in a cuckoo world in that sense, that I have to know the reality and the authentic Christian walk. And my Christian walk has to be authentic. There are some values that are embedded in each one of us that speak of the God we serve, and we know what's authentic about that. N.T. Wright speaks about it. He speaks about seven of them, and he calls them signposts. He says things like justice and love and spirituality and beauty and freedom and truth and power. Those are things that are in us. There are others. It's not a finite list. There are other things that are inside of us. They're built into our humanness, but they speak to the very depths of who our God is and what he is like and what we expect of him and what we're expecting to be. And we all have these things deep inside of us. And I mean, we know it's true because on the kids' playground, they all know what justice is. They're very quick to call unfair. If something's unfair, you know, that's not fair. We had a situation just recently where Jane was busy baking in the kitchen, and she was being helped by our youngest grandson. He's all of 4 years of age, and at the age of four, you know, help in the kitchen may or may not be help, but he was there. And she got to a very critical stage in what she was doing in this creation with aluminium foil around and whatever, and he reached out to grab it, and she reacted. And he stepped back in horror and said, I'm sorry, Granny, but you know, it's like playing a game and not knowing the rules. And in us, at the age of four, he knows what's justice. And we know that. And we are living at the moment in a situation in the world where there is no justice, there is no truth, the beauty is being attacked, there are things that are not right. And these values or signposts, they point in many ways to the realm of a God who is good and loving and kind. And so justice and love and freedom and truth, they all point in some glorious way to the God we serve. But in many of our minds, they represent a heavenly place that we as humans are not involved in and we can't get to. And not only that, we as humans are busy destroying them over and over and over in the world. There seems to be no place for truth in our world at the moment. It's been one of my big crises through this time. What is truth? Where do we find truth? And our hope is that one day in the by and by, all these things will be resolved when we get to heaven, as if we are going to some place out there. But much of our faith is based on, well, I believe this anyway, on an unrealistic spirituality that keeps us going, but it's really way out there. It's the by and by, and it's not always biblically sound. Much of that thinking came from Greek philosophy, which spiritualized our theology and took away the biblical truths that grounded us in our everyday reality and made it possible for our lives to be real and true. And we need to come back to the cross, where all of this comes together. Can I say that? We've got to come back to the cross, where all of these things that in some way have affected our lives negatively over the season and what we find ourselves in. These things, all these glorious values that we deep down carry in our hearts, as we contemplate the cross, now heading into Easter, we need to just know these things are all coming together in that, because every one of these noble values of justice and love and spirituality and beauty and freedom and truth and power, they all failed for Jesus. All of them. And many others. All of these noble traits I've mentioned came crashing down around our Savior. There was no justice for Jesus. The love with which he washed the feet of Judas was dashed to the ground when Judas betrayed him. There was no beauty in the cross. As for truth, Pilate just sneered at it and walked away. And it all came crashing down at the foot of the cross. But that is the glory of it all, because it brings you and it brings me to the foot of the cross, where Jesus answers all of these things in who he is and what he did for us. He meets with us where every single one of us is in our place of disappointment, in our place of hurt, suffering misunderstandings, living under fake news, facing illnesses and deaths and failed businesses or any other kind of endeavors that life has dealt us a horrible hand in, and they all meet somehow. Somehow, all of these things come together at the foot of the cross in the one who went through it all and took it to the cross. The late Cardinal Archbishop of Paris, Jean-Marie Lusiger, he tells a story, well, he used to tell the story when he was alive, of the three boys who played a trick on the local priest by going into the confessional and confessing all kinds of wild stories. And the first two ran away. The first two boys ran away, but the priest wasn't fooled. He gave the third boy, who happened to be Jewish, he gave him a penance to perform. He told him to go to the far end of the church to look at the large crucifix hanging there and to say to the figure on the cross, "You did it all, you did all that for me, and I don't give a damn." And he told the little boy, he said, "Go and do that three times." So off the boy went. It was still part of the game. And he got to the back of the church and he looked up at that crucifix, to the body hanging on the cross. And he said, "You did all that for me," he said, "and I don't give a damn." And then he said it a second time. And then he couldn't say it a third time, because he broke down and he sobbed. And he left the church a changed person. And then the Archbishop said this. He said, "And the reason I know that story is that I was that young man." When we look upon the cross through this coming week of Passion to Easter, and as we contemplate what Jesus did for us on that cross, every disappointment, every trial, every difficulty you're going through, he went through it, and it comes to the foot of the cross. And that Cardinal Archbishop spent the rest of his life following and serving the Jesus who had come to the place of that brokenness, of that place of failure and lies, and the Jesus who met him there loved him to the end. And that's what he's going to do for you. There remain many mysteries in our walk. Many mysteries in our walk with Jesus that I don't understand, many things I have battled with theologically that could trip me up and cause me to doubt in some way. But I want to tell you this today. This one thing I know. Jesus came for me. And Jesus came for you. Right into the midst of my situation and your situation. And nothing you are going through or will ever go through surprises him. And nothing can separate him from us. Romans 8:35, who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or danger or sword? As it is written, for your sake we are being killed all the day long, and we are regarded as sheep to be slaughtered. No, in all these things we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am sure that neither death nor life, nor angels, nor rulers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. But you know, if the story ended there, we'd have reason to be miserable. We would. If the story ended on the cross, we'd be miserable. But I want to remind you today, remember the third day, Friday, Saturday, Sunday. Because on the third day, as the old preacher said, Sunday is a-coming. And in 1 Corinthians 15, verse 1, we read, and if our hope in Christ is only for this life, we are more to be pitied than anyone in the world. But in fact, Christ has been raised from the dead. He is the first of a great harvest of all who have died. And we're going to be part of that great harvest. So you see, just as death came into the world through a man, now the resurrection from the dead has begun through another man. Just as everyone dies because we all belong to Adam, everyone who belongs to Christ will be given new life. But there's an order to this resurrection. Christ was raised as the first of the harvest. Then all who belong to Christ will be raised when he comes back. And after that, the end will come, when he will turn the kingdom over to God the Father, having destroyed every ruler and authority and power. That's what's still coming. And Palm Sunday was not the beginning of the end. It was just the end of the beginning. Because on Palm Sunday, the next chapter began, and he meets us in our brokenness. And it all came down at the cross, but Sunday is a-coming. And even today, wherever you are, whatever your circumstance, whatever COVID has done to you or anything else has done to you, we all meet at the foot of the cross in some form of brokenness, all of us, in a broken world and a broken land. But I remind you today that as you look up at that cross, it's bare. It's bare. Our Jesus is no longer there. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he rules and reigns over the entire universe. He's been resurrected, incorruptible, the firstborn among many, of which we will be some. And he's coming back for you. Amen.